Tashlakachokma, Saholshifua, Ihoitana, Chikasha Michachata Saya, Gabriel Inyotongva, Olako, Yagni Mako, Akisahanchi, Bika Natoka, Hachimanolili. Hi, everyone, and welcome. I'm Shannon Speed, and I'm Chickasaw and Choctaw by descent, and I'm a citizen of the Chickasaw Nation, and I am the director of the UCLA American Indian Studies Center. In my greeting in Chickasaw, I recognize the Gabriel Inyotongva peoples as the traditional land caretakers of Tovanga, the unceded land that encompasses much of what is currently called Los Angeles, as well as the South Channel Islands, and upon which the American Indian Studies Center and UCLA reside. The American Indian Studies Center is thrilled to co-sponsor this event with the American Indian Student Association, AISA. It's wonderful to kick off the academic year. So Hashlaka Chukma, welcome to our special guest and to all of you. Thank you for joining us. Chukmashki.
Yaha. Hello, my name is Desiree Badagan, and I am an enrolled member of the Gabrielino Banda Mission Indians. I also represent AISA as the vice chair. I would like to take this time to honor the land that UCLA occupies. I would like to recognize that the American Indian Student Association and the American Indian Studies Center at UCLA acknowledges the Gabrielino Tongva and Kish peoples as the traditional caretakers of Tovangar. As a land grant institution, we pay our respects to the Hovikvatam ancestors, Ihihurom elders, and Iohinkam, our relatives, relations, past, present, and emerging. Thank you.
Thank you, Desiree. Hello, everyone. My name is Pamela J. Peters. I am the event coordinator at the UCLA American Indian Studies, and we'd like to welcome you as well. As a Diné woman on Tovangar, I too would like to pay my respects to the Tongva ancestors and also acknowledge the other tribes, the surrounding tribes, the Chumash, the Tatavian, Kawiya, and the many, many more. I understand I'm a visitor here among the Tongva people, and for that, I would like to say thank you. And based on our responses from previous events, we have decided to allow today's events to continue beyond the 1 hour that we initially advertised so that everyone can ask their questions. And we hope you can all stay, but we understand if you are not able to. So thank you and welcome.
Welcome, everybody. Thank you all for coming. My name is Coconut Kenny. I'm Yurok from Northern California, and one of the student co-chairs of UCLA's American Indian Student Association. Today, we are presenting this event not only to showcase the amazing work of Steven Paul Judd, but also to celebrate the indigenous voices on this platform and commemorate and celebrate Indigenous People's Day on Monday, October 12th. In celebration of Indigenous People's Day, the American Indian Studies Center has created a banner to inform the public of this important day. The banner says Indigenous Peoples Day is the second Monday in October. You can see this banner from October 12th through October 16th on Brew and Walk this quarter. So this is the first event AISA is presenting this year. So we are super excited for Steven Paul Judd to be joining us today. The way we will start this is I'm going to read Steven's bio. Then he will go into his presentation, and thereafter, we will bring him back onto our virtual stage so that we can ask him a few questions. And if you do have any questions, we ask if you could please ask them via the chat box, and we will read them out later on. That would be great. So Steven Paul Judd is Kiowa and Choctaw from Oklahoma. He's a filmmaker, director, screenwriter, writer of fiction and visualist. He's a member of the Writers Guild of America and served as staff writer for Disney XD comedy series Zeke and Luther. Judd's filmography is large in scope and provides a unique perspective on and from within Native American culture today. His innovative approach provides a glimpse into a world that is familiar to the underrepresented first peoples of this nation and simultaneously brings about a fresh perspective and understanding among the non-Indian community through humor. Judd's filmography has earned him many honors and awards, and the Native American population has embraced his work with an outpour of support and encouragement to continue creating. Known primarily as a filmmaker, he is also a prolific visualist whose mashups of Native experiences and disposable American pop culture are sly and often straight up funny. His creations include paintings, prints, poster art, photography, and t-shirt designs. In 2015, he designed the cover and merchandise for the group A Tribe Called Red. His mural, War Paint, can also be seen at historic Indian Alley in downtown Los Angeles. We would again just like to thank you, Steven, for being here. And now we would pass the time over to you.
All right, thank you so much. And thank you everyone for joining us this afternoon. And before I begin, I also want to thank the UCLA American Indian Student Association, the American Indian Studies Center, and Pamela J. Peters for putting this on and reaching out to me. I've known Pamela for a long time. She actually produced the first short film I ever directed called Search for the World's Best Indian Taco. So it was really good to connect with her again. And thanks for everyone for having me. Okay, all right. So what I'm gonna be doing here is I'm gonna do a little bit of sharing my screen with you guys. So we're gonna do video, images. So it's kind of be back and forth. So I'm gonna try to share my screen real quick. Let me see what I can do here. Okay. So someone's gonna have to let me know if this is actually working. How do I do this?
Okay. I can let you know.
Okay, yeah. So let me know. Do you see a cartoon of me right now?
Yes.
Okay, cool. So we'll watch this.
I've always loved film, but what happened was when I was little, I was born in Oklahoma, but we moved to Mississippi, and I lived on like 19 acres in the country. And I guess, my dad's dad was like really super religious, and he thought the TV was the devil, so we didn't have a TV. So I had polio when I was younger, so I was in the kindergarten, and I had a surgery on my leg so I could walk, and there was a TV. And I said, what is that? And they said, that's TV. So they turned it on, and a movie called Wizard of Oz was playing. So as you remember, Wizard of Oz started off in black and white, and then it turned into color. So I saw the invention of TV, black and white and color, like in 20 minutes. So I was freaking out. And then these monkeys came out and started flying. And I started crying. And I told them to turn it off, because I thought that it was the devil. So I went home, and I told my brothers and sisters, there's this thing called TV. Mom and Dad have been holding out on us, so we bugged them. We just took that hit so fine. My parents, they didn't care. Like, they're all right, so they bought us a TV. But what was really funny is they bought us a black and white TV, and this crowd probably old enough to know, but it was not uncommon to have a black and white TV at one time. But the thing was, there was a show called Incredible Hulk, and I didn't know about cartoons or comics, so I didn't know about the Incredible Hulk except for TV. And my cousin came to visit. He's like, I'm the Incredible Hulk. I'm gonna get mad and turn green. And I was like, what? The Incredible Hulk's green? Because it was that black and white TV. I thought it just got big and muscular.
So one of the things probably.
All right, cool. So let me go to, I'm sorry guys, I'm trying to navigate these, there should be something on here that said, there it is, my presentation, UCLA. All right, cool. All right, can you guys see me with some Rubik's Cubes right now?
Yes.
Okay, awesome. Okay, so I know I talked kind of fast in that little video, but basically what I was trying to say was that when I was growing up, I didn't know what television was until I went to the hospital. And then when we finally did get a TV, it was a black and white TV. I didn't have color TV. So if you would have told me at that age that I was looking at media for representation of myself, I would have thought that was psychobabble. I said, oh man, I don't care who it is. I'm just looking for funny stories or scary stories. I don't really care that they look like me. It was only when I got older and I started looking back at things that I watched and things that I gravitated to that I realized, man, I was trying to find someone that looked like me or someone that looked like someone from my family. When I was a kid, right now, it's such a cool time because you can find native entertainment now. Of course, not as much as we want, but there's definitely some out there. But when I was a kid, there was only three guys I remember. One was the guy in the middle. Now, some of you guys are too young to remember this, but there was a commercial with a guy named Iron Eyes Cody. And now it seems weird, but for especially you that are in college right now, it was not unusual to see an adult throw their trash out the window. You'd be driving down the road, someone roll their window down, and they'd throw out McDonald's. It was so common for people to litter that they had to make a public service announcement, a commercial, reminding adults to quit littering. So what they did was they had this Indian dude dressed up in buckskin, and you can see it on YouTube, he's in a canoe, and milk jugs are hitting his canoe, and then he stands up on this hill, and maybe a trash bag hits him in the face and he starts crying. But anyway, he was actually Sicilian. He was not Native American. He was a Italian actor. Then on the far right, that's Jay Silverheels. He played a character called Tonto. And that was a rerun when I was a kid. And he talked kind of in a pidgin English, and I'm not really good at impressions, but it was something like this: white man speak 'em with fork 'em tongue. And then on the far left, some of you may recognize that. That's a guy named Eric Estrada. He played a character named Ponch on a TV show called Chips. Now, he never claimed to be Native American. I believe he was Puerto Rican, but I thought he looked like my uncle. So every Friday night, I'd be like, man, I got to watch my uncle. He's a, you know, he's on TV. It was just the idea of seeing someone that looked like my family. So I thought, man, one day when I grow up, I'm going to make what I consider cool things for Indian people that look like something that talks to the experience that I had growing up. I grew up, as the video said, I was born in Oklahoma, but I started my formal education in Mississippi on the Choctaw Reservation. I am Choctaw and Kiowa. I'm enrolled Kiowa tribe of Oklahoma from the Southern Plains. So I want to skip ahead in life to when I first started doing art, and then we'll wrap our way back down. So when I was in the second grade, I was in an art contest, draw your favorite book. So I drew this book and I ended up winning first place. And how good can you draw in the first or second grade? Not very good, but I think my mom knew the teacher, so there was probably a hookup going on. So anyway, I won it. And that teacher told me, man, you're a good drawer. And I believed her. So after that, I was like, you know, hey, I'm a good artist. This lady said I was good. So I kind of believe that if you tell someone they're good at something, they're going to believe it and they're going to start getting better at it and they're going to practice at it, and it'll be kind of self-fulfilling. So I come to Oklahoma and I needed some art. I love pop art. So I Googled Native American pop art. This was probably 9 or 10 years ago. And have you ever mistyped something in Google and Google doesn't know what you want? So it only puts like 7 pictures up. It's like a picture of a garden hose and a cat, maybe a recliner, because it's like, it doesn't know. That's what happened then. If you type in pop art now, Native American pop art, there's pages and pages. But at that time, there wasn't much. Bunky Echo Hawk showed up, which is an amazing artist. Another artist, Greg Deal's a great pop artist, I think might have showed up. Fritz Scholder, older, T.C. Cannon. There was a few things, but not a lot. So I was thinking, man, I'll just paint my own then. I won a contest in the second grade. I can do this. So I painted something that I wanted to see. It was a bottle cap with this Native dude on there. And so I don't know why, but I videotaped it and put it online. And someone was like, I'll buy that from you. I'm like, you'll buy this from me? Today, I am an artist. So I just started painting stuff. One of the things I painted was this powwow bear for the Care Bears. My sister liked the Care Bears growing up. Care Bear Stare, for any of you out there that know that. I painted this. Fry Bread and Spam by Dr. Sue. I hooked him up with the braids on his head. And I grew up, you know, not eating the healthiest, but we did eat Spam and Fry Bread. So I just kind of want to give a nod to that vibe. There's this magic eight ball that you can shake and you'll be like, magic eight ball, you know, where should I go eat? And usually I'll say stuff like, odds are not good or something like that. So I made one, a Native one, and it says she's your cousin on it. Then I turned it into a real one. I actually physically made one. You can shake up. It had like 4 answers on it. This is a powwow ranger. This was acrylic on canvas. One thing I noticed going to school is every year, you guys probably remember this, it'd be like, oh, time to study the Indians. But then when they'd study natives, it would always start when Christopher Columbus got here. So I made this little image. Native American history didn't begin in 1492. As I said earlier, although I'm enrolled Kiowa, I'm also Choctaw. So if you closed your eyes and imagined a Native American, an indigenous person to the United, you know, to this continent, most people, not all, maybe not this crowd here, but most of the time people will close their eyes and imagine a guy in a feathers and horse and teepees. Well, the Kiowas did live that way. So the Kiowa tribe did that way. But the Choctaw side of my family, they didn't. They had textiles. They were trading early. So this is a traditional Choctaw dress that I put on the Morton Salt girl, and I kind of darkened her skin. these are some shoes I made. I just took a pair of Converse and I wanted to see some natives on there. So I went into a comic book shop and I was like, hey, I'd like to have, are there any native comic books in here? And they're like, they're called graphic novels. And I'm like, your store says Atomic Comic. Why doesn't it say Atomic Graphic Novel? I don't even know what's going on. So he says, no, we don't have any Indian comics. And I said, well, do you have any Lone Ranger? So he says, yes. So it took me, I think I had to buy 6 issues to get enough native imagery to cover these. And I thought comics were like 50 cents, but apparently they're $4 and $5. So you can make those shoes too, but they're only good for one wear. They fall apart after because it's just comic books. Okay, these two guys, oh my gosh. Do you know who they are? Some of you probably do. Let's start with the guy on the right, my right. I think it's your right too, I guess. That's a guy named Jim Thorpe. Okay, so some of you may be like, I think I've heard that name. Who is Jim Thorpe? Okay, everyone has probably heard of the NFL, the National Football League. Did you know that a native was the first president of the NFL? That's right. Jim Thorpe was the first president of the NFL. He was also a pentathlon. This picture is very famous. If you look him up, you see this picture, look at his feet, you'll see that he's wearing mismatched shoes. He was in the pentathlon and someone stole his shoes, so he had to wear mismatched shoes and he ended up winning gold. In 1950, the Associated Press took a vote on who was the greatest athlete in the world. Keep in mind that his heyday was in the 30s and so was Babe Ruth. 1950, Jim Thorpe won the votes by like 70% as being the best athlete. In 2000, they took the vote again. I think Michael Jordan might have won then, which is fine, whatever. However, somehow between 1950 and 2000, Babe Ruth jumped Jim Thorpe. I don't even think Babe Ruth was alive, and somehow he was able to jump him. He got 70% better. So that's an interesting thing that we can talk about on another day, but we should know about that. So that's Jim Thorpe. And the guy on the left is a cat named Billy Mills. Please, I would encourage you after this is over, go to YouTube and type in Billy Mills race. And you'll see Billy Mills running. Billy Mills is Oglala Lakota. Oh, and Jim Thorpe is Sac and Fox and Potawatomi. Billy Mills, Oglala Lakota. I think he's the only American, not just the only native, but he's the only American to win gold in the 10K at the Tokyo Olympics. It's an amazing race. I hope you guys check it out. And both of these guys, went to a school called Haskell Indian Nations University, which is located in Lawrence, Kansas. It's an all-native school. I also went to school there. Both of these guys won gold medals, and I had perfect attendance in kindergarten. So go Haskell, nothing but winners going on up there. So these are res pezes. I like to collect these little res pez, pez dispensers. So I made this little res pez. I guess when you open up their head or something, maybe like cheese or something will come out. I'm not really sure, but you can use that to your own imagination. Oh my gosh. Okay, we're gonna watch some stop motions that I make later. I've loved stop motion since I was a kid. One of the more kind of famous one was a Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer one and a Frosty the Snowman one. When I was a kid, it played every year. I call this the Indian that saved Christmas. Okay, you may or may not know this, but if you don't, I would encourage you to look it up afterwards. Did you know that we had native on currency here? That's right. The $5 silver certificate had a native dude on it. It looks so dope. To me, at least, I thought it looked dope. For those of you don't know, Andrew Jackson, if you're indigenous, he hated you and your ancestors. This cat is horrible. He does not deserve to be on the $20 bill. So these are not Photoshop. I took matte pencils and some magic markers and drew on them to make them look like this. I did like 6 of them like this. And I remember this is when I first started doing art and I was really hungry. So about 3 of them I actually used to go eat on. So I actually paid with my meal with 3 of these. This is the piece that was mentioned in the bio. I did this in downtown Los Angeles. My idea was to take war paint and rebrand it. And the idea was that anyone that uses ink to further a social cause, that would be their war paint. So that's why I made this. And I kind of vibed off of, there's that country singer, he sings This Sound Is Your Land, Woody Guthrie. If you look at his guitar, it says, "This machine kills fascists." And then also Greg Deal had a really cool spray paint can that I really liked too. So definitely shout outs to both those guys, because without them, this would not have been made. I really liked the movie Star Wars growing up. What I tried to do was I found a correlation between the story of Star Wars and the indigenous people of this land and the government. So if you haven't seen the movie Star Wars, it's about this ragtag group of rebels fighting against this oversized evil empire that's coming over trying to take over their land. So I always, like when I can, I like to mix those two images together just because to me it works on two levels. This is called My Great-Great-Grandmother is a Hopi Indian Princess. So again, we're looking at a character from Star Wars, Princess Leia, and some Hopi women. And as you can see, the hairstyle is strikingly similar. I took a Starbucks cup and I just drew on it, tried to make it look like a jingle dress dancer. Some of you may know that I make stickers. I have over 106 sticker designs that I sell on studus.com. Exit through the gift shop hashtag. And so I put them on this helmet and gave this away last year, I think during Christmas time. I just put all my stickers on a helmet and did a little giveaway. This is Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, the traditional version. So it's like, it has a different ending than the one that, that you're probably used to seeing. Okay, so I was very fortunate to be able to go to Paris, France to show a short film I made called Ronnie Bodine. While I was there, I visited a place called, and forgive me for pronouncing this wrong, but it's something like the Arc de Triomphe. And if you look, that's my hand holding this little Lego man. I thought it looked like a giant Lego guy walking through the city. This looks like an easy picture to take, but it wasn't. If you've ever been there, you'll know that it's a road on both sides and cars are going by and there's all these tourists behind you yelling like, hurry up, we want to take our picture. And I was like, leave me alone, I'm scared, I'm trying. Anyway, it was harder to get than it looked. This is called, I Think We're Gonna Need a Bigger Canoe. Now, for those of you old enough to remember the movie Jaws, you remember that was a famous line from the movie, but it was called, it said, I think we're gonna need a bigger boat is what the actual line is. This is a piece that I did on canvas. All I did was add the Monopoly Man and colored the buildings that were there. I thought they looked just like the Monopoly house and hotels. This is actually, if I am not mistaken, those are boarding schools. This is Fox and Mox, just a fun little painting I did. These are just Indians watching Indians, you know, at the drive-in or something like that. I took my cell phone and these little dudes and some fake grass kind of thing and just made it look like they were watching smoke signals. When I was growing up, there were some movies, every now and then you would find a movie where there was a dope natives in there that I thought was portrayed funny, smart. So from left, and I just made this image where it looked like they were all going to the casino one night. So from left to right, we have Graham Greene in the movie Dances with Wolves. The next one, a lot of people will get the actor right, but they get the wrong movie. This is Chief Dan George from the movie Outlaw Josie Wales. It was a Clint Eastwood movie. He's really great in that movie. In the middle, we have the Creek actor, Muskogee, an actor from the movie, I think it was an Oscar-winning movie called One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. Really a dope movie. And if you read the book, it was all told from the native's perspective or in his mind or his viewpoint. So if you, that's Will Sampson, by the way. Then we have, some people get the right actor on this one. Obviously, Gary Farmer, for those of you in the know, that's actually from the movie Powwow Highway, a character named Filbert. And then on the far right, oh man, everyone probably knows him out of all of them from Smoke Signals. Hey, Victor, you know, so, sorry about your dad. You know, so Evan Adams is the actor. I love this picture. So, speaking of Power Highway and movies like Star Wars, I loved action figures growing up. They were like, I love them now. I just love action figures. I think they're really cool. But they didn't really make action figures for what I felt like they were making for movies that I dug. So I made this action figure. I took a Simpsons doll and I used a Sharpie and colored his hair. And then I printed out Filbert's shirt and glued it on him and the belt buckle. Then I got in Photoshop and kind of made what I thought it could look like and printed it out on cardstock. And then I went to the dollar store and bought this Batman action figure. So I got that plastic piece and made this. Now I will admit, it looks good on the photo, but in real life, that's pretty. It's a pretty flimsy back. It's not the hard cardboard like you would imagine, and it's not glued there. So it looks really cool to me right now, but in real life, you'd probably say that thing looks like a craft piece and not very good. I took the cover to the Native People's Magazine of Jim Thorpe, and then I cobbled a bunch of Legos together. So I think it was a football one and a rugby one, and I was able to make this. Now, as you can see, I didn't do the C very well. It was really small, and I was trying to use scissors. Today, if I were to do it, I would totally, you know, get an exact, I would make this look so dope, but this is what I made back then. And again, this looks really cool now, but in real life, because I was using acrylic paint, like all of the purple looks really clumpy and dry in real life, so. But it looks cool on a photo, I think. This is one I made of Billy Mills. Oh my gosh, the custom Billy Mills. Lego looks really cool. 722 was his actual number. Oh man, when I was growing up, there was this movie called Ghostbusters that my brother used to love to watch. So I actually kind of made this with him in mind. There was a movie in the 70s called The Warriors. And I had a dream that there, it was all Native people. So if you look up this poster, in the Warriors poster, you'll see it's just like this, but it's like a drawing of the characters from the movie. So this was, I thought one day I'll be able to make this. And eventually I was able to learn Photoshop and I was able to build this little image. Downtown Oklahoma City, I was asked to put an image on a wall. This is the image I came up with. I wanted it to be in that style of Banksy, who is probably my most favorite artist of all time, Banksy. So it says this space for rent, and then I took a spray can and wrote the word not. Not. Oh man, here we go. The world's greatest race. We got Jim Thorpe versus the Flash. I was in DC speaking at the Smithsonian, and I just Googled Native Americans in Washington DC, black and white old photos. I believe this was from 1905. And then I walked over until I found the building that was taken and I just held it up. I think it looks pretty cool. This is Rock'em Sock'em Robots Battle Little Bighorn Edition, a vintage toy that I just wanted to do my own little spin on. I was watching the news and I saw this thing, and please look this up so that you know I'm not lying. It's called the Nun Bun. It's a cinnamon bun that looks like Mother Teresa. And then there was one like Elvis in a tortilla, Jesus on the side of a building. I'm like, why does no one see an Indian people in their food? So I fixed that. This is called the Toast of Indian Country. And this is made by a technique called the grid technique. This is a technique that before COVID, I would fly probably once a month to different communities, organizations, or college campuses and teach people the grid technique. It's a super simple technique and you don't even have to be artistic, and I can teach this to you. It's really dope. So it's something you should really try to learn to do. It's really easy, or bring me out to your community and I'll teach you. These are just Mendians. This is the indigenous Hulk who gets mad when treaties are broken. So you see down there, he sees treaties are broken. He's like, ah, I'm gonna stay mad. This is a rug. When I was a kid, I used to make these things called mixtapes, right? So like I'd get my recorder and I'd wait for the song to come on, you know, the countdown. I'd record the song that I wanted, and then I'd wait for the next one and I'd try to fade them in and out using a tape deck. And then I'd put like, Steven Paul Judd's Mega Mix Volume 2. Like, no one cares. No one would see this mixtape and be like, oh, where's Volume 1? I must have missed that. Please let us hear that. But I did it anyway. I made this Powwow Mixtape Volume 2. So it's a rug that I make. I don't physically make it, just so you know. I'm not didn't weave it myself or nothing. These are some chapsticks that we sell on NTVS. There's a website down there at the bottom. Funny thing about this. So I had this idea for this. I thought it'd be really cool. I sent it in. It says fried bread grease, but actually it's vanilla, I think. So we sent it in, and the company's like, you need to tell us the ingredients. So I just wrote back in the email, it's 100% real, kind of joking. And that's what they put for the ingredients down there, 100% real. So anyway, no one's lips have fallen off, so I guess it's safe. These are some emojis that we're working on right now, even as we speak, to try to get, we made these years and years ago. And I've been trying to get these turned into emojis, and it's super hard to get it done. But eventually we hope, we actually have about, I think, five more that we have that aren't even on here. So stay tuned. I would say before Christmas, you will be able to get these. And our plan is to give them away free for the first day and then charge. So it's going to be free for the first day. Tell your friends. I turned wrong way into strong medicine. Just let it be known. I did not steal this sign. I bought it off of eBay and then paid it. So I like to make skate decks. The one on top was a ledger drawing that I tried to make look like it was three-dimensional. So yeah, I think it kind of looks, it's flat but 3D at the same time, kind of dope. It gets cold in the Southern Plains. I just made this because it really does get cold here, and that's a tauntaun from Empire Strikes Back. Again, that was the side that the rebels, they used to ride the tauntaun, so I wanted to make sure we had a native person riding the tauntaun. That's just an Ewok. The Ewoks were, they were allies. They were allies to the rebels. So that's what I want to do here. Let's look at a little meeting here. That's just Godzilla, man, fighting the colonizers, man, the invaders. He's helping out. Okay, so if you look at this, it looks like an Etch-a-Sketch. But actually, if you look up close, up top, it says ledger sketch. This is actually a canvas. And then what I did was I took Mod Podge lids and then I glued them onto the canvas itself to make it look like it was a ledger. And I actually just drew it with a pen. This is a no parking sign again. I paid for this. I didn't steal it. And I just drew on it. It says no parking. I like to do that with street signs. This is a piece I call quarter horse. It was just, you know, those horses that are in front of grocery stores. So if anyone has one of those, I'd love to buy it from you because I like to do this in real life. So when you put money in, it actually plays like Tribe Called Red or something, or maybe some powwow music. This is Indian Up. Look at that little teepee back there. This is a piece I did with Summer Peters. I think she goes by Mama Long Legs. She's an Ojibwe bead worker. I just painted the Wonder Woman and I gave her brown eyes and she came through and hooked up the beadwork. Oh, this is kind of dope to me. This is full size. You can't tell, but this is a full size buffalo. I mean, it's probably 3 feet wide. What I did was I took a buffalo head, wrapped it up in saran wrap, then used about 12 rolls of tape, taped it up. Then I cut it back off, put it back together. It probably weighs less than 1 pound. I was so excited. I wanted people to see it. That I didn't know how to hang it on the wall. I figured out a way, but this is actually my floor. I just put it on the floor, put some paintings on the floor, and just took the photo. Let's make it look like it's on the wall. This is a Van shirt that I did. If you look, you can see the Vans, anything in color, that was the Vans logo, and those are straight lines inside. Then outside, I used a more sketch kind of drawing. They gave those away free at the All Nations Skate Jam. I wanted to do an image that talked about all the trash that are going in the ocean. So I thought, what is the most famous wave? And it's this painting, The Great Wave. So I made this image. I saw a tutorial online that showed you how to turn your sneakers into a comic book. So I did. This is kind of neat because this is something called forced perspective. That car and those toys are small. Neither of them are full size. And this is not done with any Photoshop. I think you can see my mouse. There's a little slight faint line right here. On this side of the line is the road. And I noticed that the cement bench looked the same. They were made out of the same, I guess, material. So I just took this photo and I just thought, man, it looks like they're huge. These are Ninja Turtles, man, shaking their shells, doing it. I took a Charles Schulz commercial cartoon, Peanuts, Charlie Brown, and I just changed what it says in the thought bubble. I wish we honored the treaties. You're a good man, Charlie Brown. So I took the Space Invaders image and I just changed it. If you look closely, you can see, you can see like I changed the ships, like Columbus's ships and stuff. So that's kind of a fun, cool image, I think. I'd like to turn that into a pinball game. Kyrie Irving, who played at the time, he played basketball for the Boston Celtics. Now I believe he's with Brooklyn. He is a Standing Rock. So N7 asked me to do a design on top of his book bag or yeah, book bag, backpack. So this is what I made. I think they had me make 15 of these. I was doing a live paint up in Canada. So we end up making like a, I just took their language and you probably recognize this. One fish, two fish, red fish, blue fish. This is the first Avenger, Captain Native America. I'm gonna zoom in so you can see here. I put a little beadwork on the chest, a little medicine wheel over here, medicine pouch. First Avenger. This is just a chair that I found on Craigslist that I painted on. There's the rug back there that we saw earlier. Oh, so I made this unbroken treaty action figure. And you might say, but there's nothing in it. Exactly, that's the point. So if you look right here, the little native dude's like, freedom of religion? And this guy says, of course, but there's like a little ash. And then down here it says, terms and conditions may apply. Right here it says $19.78. That's not how much it cost. That's actually the year 1978. So we've been talking about Star Wars. You know Star Wars. That came out before Native American Religious Rights Act was passed. Are you kidding me? We didn't actually technically have the right to practice our religion until after Star Wars came out. So crazy. Even though you hear people say, this country was built on freedom of religion. Terms and conditions may apply. Oh, I think you have to turn your head sideways on this. This is 500 pieces of Rubik's cubes that I made into an image. That's King Kong. Get away, you old colonizer. There was a book that I loved as a kid called Where the Wild Things Are. So on this one, little Max is talking about, he's scaring the wild things with the story. You'll never guess what happened. And it's freaking the wild things out. So this is an image I made using dice. And I'll show you the final product. I think I have a video of it that I'm gonna show you. 20,000 dice. There's the final product under glass. It's 9 feet tall, 6 feet wide. If I had to guess, over 400 pounds. It was so heavy. This is another piece. This one is around 15,000 dice. It's probably 800 pounds because I used a solid, we made a solid cedar frame. This piece I made during the Sundance Film Festival, right before COVID and everything got locked down. So that piece is still in Salt Lake City. So if anyone wants to buy it, shoot me that DM. It's in Salt Lake City waiting for you. Okay, cool. So we're gonna go out. I wanna show you a few videos, some fun stuff. Let me move this here. I just gotta move this guy here so we can see. Is that the one? This is it. Nope. Let's get rid of that guy. Okay, this is the dot. Oh man. This is kind of neat. That's what they call a Canadian tuxedo, denim on denim. I don't know who put this together, but I think I'm glad they did. What the heck? Oh my gosh, this guy. Pretty cool, super proud of this piece. Okay, I would love to show you a few more things here. I think we've got enough time. Let me see, oh my gosh. Okay, I'm gonna hurry. Okay, sorry everybody. Let's go to, no, I won't show you that one. We'll watch, this is kind of cool. Stop motion, you guys will dig this. This is really quick, a little stop motion. I am the voice of Uncle Jesse, in case you're wondering.
Not again. This is the third time this month someone's vandalized the top of the general. We better call the law, cousin.
Maybe it's because all the baggage that comes with that flag.
That's a flag? We thought it was just a cool design with stars and whatnot. Uncle Jesse, did you know it was a flag?
Boys, I got some chores to tend to. You know, a chicken in the bread pan, chicken out.
Most folks that know a little history realize the states of the South that fly this flag were seceding to keep slaves.
Now, wait a minute, Roscoe. We got Ken that fought on the side of the South. They wasn't for no slavery. They was for states' rights.
Well, someone should have told your ancestors that, because they thought it was about slavery. In fact, they included it in their secession letter. Loretta Miss Chad shows how many woods were devoted to the issue of slavery.
Look out, cousin. The storm's washed out the bridge.
Hang on.
Okay. That was awesome. Oh, I think it was. I'm not sure. Let's watch this. This is really dope too. I think I could be wrong. Made this with Ryan Redcorn and Paul Snyder.
Aquí, aquí, Chacuanian. We come along, kisam sonanak, uchiya koma kitahan. Pionk, kwa watki kuchi kiwan, kwa pam kuki. We yum ti yok anak, ta wikatamawan. Kachanai, Mata Kawahoa, Yuski Tompak, Apabo Ko, Wa Ata Nisma Shoi, Haki Masmam Kiwawa, Kanichonan, Petayamawa, Watquanunak, Aki Ayatu Wayak, Qua Aki, Wakusawak, I Mantu. In Kakiha Tatwuchi, Witapotan, Sayakat Matan, Ayotama Wina. Matamai katikwanonak, pionsh in wachonamak, aisashan, tiakwash, wosho kwanawak. Tanit ni mataunun, tapin iawash wuchi, na natai, ni tato chakwan I, wachonamak mashoyash. Mashoyash, akweni wokwat pamasaswak, na yashawak. Ayanama week Nataya Sanawak. Chakwan awi machi chakwan maskawa chak.
Naks kat matapawak o kawi tabatamawak.
Go back. How do I? Sorry, guys. What is going on? Why is it doing this? I'm trying to like, oh, there we go. Okay, don't worry. Grandpa's figuring this out. Don't worry. Okay. That was the Mohican language. I tried to actually get some other tribes that were actually had first contacts. And if you ever dealt with tribes, it's a little tough. I'll just say that. It was so funny. I was just like, man, I just need you someone to see. Anyway. Let's go. Okay, let me show you two more things. This is kind of cool. I think I could be wrong. That's not the one. I'm gonna move this thing here. Okay, action.
Aki, it told me Charlie.
Okay, this is the wrong link. There should be some subtitles. So I'll tell you what they're saying. And then he says, Dad, why do they call them pallbearers? And then Dad said, that's just what they call them. And he says something to the effect of, your grandfather, before he walked on, he left you something in your room.
I asked a minty kanima.
A mafo ayo pache.
Pity
Piti, chimpa, kapisa.
Oh, he says, come eat. He's telling him to come eat. All right, and then this is the last video. This is the first video I ever made. Back when I got back to Oklahoma, I made this for, I think, $12. And anyway.
Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed.
All right, and I want to show you guys something that literally maybe five people in the whole world have seen. This is top secret. Well, I don't know if it's top secret, but it's something new I have coming out that no one's seen. I don't even know when it's coming out, but here we go. This is something I've been working on for a little while. I have a comic book that I'm going to release. It's called Little Res Detectives. And it's about these two, this guy, this little boy and girl who form a detective agency. And so anyway, I guess I forgot this is being recorded, so I should probably turn that off. All right. So, okay, cool. How do I stop sharing? Boom. All right. Can you guys see me now? Am I back here on the screen?
You're back.
I'm back. We're back live. I also make stuff. I make little, what are these things called? Notebooks. Oh man, pretty cool, pretty cool. And I made this belt. You guys probably can't see it, but it's really dope. And I colored all those in Photoshop, these old black and white photos. Printed them, put them on there. I made my own bands that look like beadwork. Oh man, got them, coach. And I made this action figure. It says Obi-Wan Kenobi after he was struck down. So you got Obi-Wan, it's just a robe. It's after Obi-Wan Kenobi got killed. So anyway, all right, are there any questions? I will say I sold a TV show 2 years ago. It's not gonna get made, but I sold it to HBO. I sold a podcast that got canceled during COVID before it ever even got started. It's a long story on that. And my dad came to visit. He stayed in the van, I stayed out. Then he took off his oxygen and got out of the van and started smoking. I was like, what in the, you took your oxygen off to smoke? And I said, is your oxygen tank, it should be sponsored by Marlboro. So I made it, I grabbed an oxygen tank and I made it, it says Marlboro. And it's, cause you know, when I was younger, you could smoke and you get these Marlboro miles. So I'm trying to teach my dad a lesson with this. Hopefully we'll see if he learns or not. Okay, all right, there we go. Any questions?
Well, I just want to say thank you on behalf of AISA, the American Student Association. I'm also one of the other student co-chairs. So yeah, now we just wanted to see if you wanted to plug any of your social media websites where people can buy prints and whatnot.
Yeah, please. We'll thank you. Yes. You. Studis.com, S-T-O-O-D-I-S, Studis.com is my personal website. Then I also have a partner at NTVS.com, the natives, NTVS.com. And then my Instagram, Steven Paul Judd. I post everything new that I put on there, every new painting, anything I build and make. Tomorrow I partnered up with a makeup company. We're releasing some makeup tomorrow that I did the packaging for. I didn't have anything to do with the makeup, but that's getting released tomorrow. Big release tomorrow.
Awesome. And now, if anyone has any questions, we're going to open it up now. You can either put them in the chat and we can read them off for you, or go ahead and unmute yourself.
Hi, Summer here. Nice to meet you. I just wanted to ask if you can pinpoint any specific moment that inspired any of your art pieces, if you have any. I just want to hear about that.
Yeah. Man, that's interesting. Good question. A lot of things happen when I wake up and I think about it. And sometimes I'll do a Google search to make sure someone else hasn't done that yet. You know, like someone had to have done this. I don't know about anything specifically, but I do know that Bunky Echo Hawk and there's another guy, he's Navajo, that I was inspired by for sure when I started, along with Banksy and a guy named Mr. Brainwash. Oh, if I think of his name, I'll remember. He does a lot of Star Wars paintings. Someone let me know. He's Singer, Ryan Singer. Singer, no, is that right? Anyway, but yeah, but not specifically a piece. I don't know specifically like what inspired a piece that I can think of right offhand, but that's it. But I will think about that. So thank you.
Megan here, I had a question. So I understand you're doing a makeup collaboration. It's releasing tomorrow. What company is that? Where can we find that?
Yes, please. Okay. If you look at Prados, P-R-A-D-O-S, Prados Beauty is what it is on ProdosBeauty.com, but that's also their Instagram. They donate 50% of their profit to Indigenous causes and communities. They've been donating PPE. It's an Indigenous female founder. So yeah, it's really, really neat. I'm glad she reached out to me and I'm glad I'm able to help. Really, I'm just trying to help her facilitate. She just wanted me to come up with some cool packaging. So it's really, she gets all the credit. It's her idea, her product. All I did was like, let me do some bright images on here for you. So that's what that is. But I'm excited to be a part of it. I think she's doing some neat stuff.
That's awesome. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, and then there's another question in the chat. Do you have any advice for Native entrepreneurs, and what's the process of starting partnerships with these different companies?
Yeah, so, I remembered an inspiration. I don't know if this is the kind of answer you were wondering for. I believe it was Summer. I was watching a show called Tattoo. It's like where they do, it was a game, not game show, but people would do tattoos as a reality show.
Ink Master.
Yes. I was watching Ink Master.
David Navarro.
Yeah. So I was watching Ink Master, and they were doing something they call a flash round, where it's like a kind of like if there's four of us ink people, we have to do this contest and beat the other ones. And they gave them like, I want to say it was 3,000 dice to make a picture. And they did. They made an eyeball. But it kind of, I was thinking, man, if you had more dice, I bet you could do a real picture is what I was thinking, because it was kind of pixelated looking. So I ordered 20,000 dice and just got on it. So that was an inspiration for that piece. And then entrepreneurs. I can tell you my first entrepreneur story. It had nothing to do with Native art. So I'm broke, man. I was living in this horrible apartment in Norman, man. People yelling outside, fighting, and it was crazy. And I was working at a bingo hall, and I needed a keychain. And I wanted one that looked like one of those motel keychains, like those old school motel keychains. And I looked online and I found one from Albuquerque. No, it was from Gallup. And they wanted $12. And I was like, $12? I wonder if I could make my own. I said, what's the most famous motel? Oh yeah, the Chateau Marmont. So I looked online and found this hospitality place. I bought like 100 of them. And I think at that time it cost me like $300. My rent was $480, you know? So I'm freaking out, like, this is all my rent. But if I sell all of them, I'll make like profit like $800, you know? So that was the first thing I ever did. I just bought a stack of them, put them in my cabinet. And then every time someone, that was the first thing I ever sold. And I would just like put it in an envelope, send it off. I'd be like, dang, that's a tank of gas today, you know? So that was the first kind of entrepreneur thing. But what I did was I decided to invest in myself. So eventually that moved to stickers. I bought 4 stickers and maybe 100 of each. So that's 400 stickers. And I saved up my money, bought that. And then finally, once I was kind of moving along, I saved up I figured out what my bills were for 1 month, rent, food, gas, cell phone. And I multiplied it times 3. And I said, I'm going to give myself 3 months. And in 3 months, if I'm broke, then I am going to give up any kind of other making stuff. And I worked at the casino then. I think I was dealing blackjack. And I said, I'm going to become the best worker at this casino. I'm just going to move up because I feel like I could be a hard worker no matter what I wanted to do. Because when I was like 19, I had my own Sonic drive-in. I was the manager. Like, I had my own store. I lived in Tennessee. I had my own store at 19 years old. So I just felt like I can be a hard worker. So if this does not work out in 3 months, I'm never doing, well, I'll still always make stuff, but I was just gonna try to become a great worker and I'd be working at a casino today. But I was fortunate that 3 months turned to 6 months, then 9 months, and eventually I had a whole year of savings and I haven't looked back since. But I do wanna say that there's ups and downs and man, I mean, you're probably, maybe people out here are like entered contests and they haven't won it. And they're like, man, I was better, I should have won that. Well, that's happened to me. But also I probably won contests where I wasn't the best. So I don't let any of it get me down. I just like keep on going. And you can't get too high or too low, because especially if you're following the arts and being an entrepreneur, man, it is like this. You're looking for quarters in the seat to eat, to having enough money. You just kind of had, I had to learn to when I got paid for a project, not to spend all the money right then. So, but a lot of taking chances on myself and investing in myself.
Thank you so much for that answer. We also have another question in the chat. As an artist, how do you channel and or filter anger? Is it easy or is it overwhelming?
Ryan Singer was the artist that I was thinking, thank you. Yes, Ryan Singer was the artist that was really a big inspiration. How do I channel anger? Is that what the question was? I'm sorry.
Yes, if the person who asked wants to elaborate, feel free.
I mean, yeah. But was that the question? How do I channel anger? Was that specifically what it said?
I'm the one who asked the question. Yes, that was a question. The question was, it's so easy to be overwhelmed by anger. I was curious how you channel it or how to get that out of your mind in your artwork. It's so humorous and funny.
I think people that know me real, I'm actually super laid back. I was fortunate. This has nothing to do with me. It's just everyone's wired different. And I got lucky to get wired with that happy-go-lucky. I'm kind of like Forrest Gump, I'm too oblivious to know what's going on around me. So that's the good part. But I'm also, man, I'm very sensitive. Like if someone writes one kind of even small negative thing, I always think, man, if I could just talk to that person, I can explain to them about this piece and they wouldn't be mad. And they probably went to bed and didn't think anything of it. I'm up all night thinking about it. And it's actually given me anxiety. Like these past two, like I just like freaking out now with the internet and like so many people follow. And I'm like, I feel like if I can explain to everyone and if someone gets mad, I don't want them to be mad. I just want to talk to them. But I don't know. So I guess I've never had to deal with the anger part of it, but I do have anxiety with social media for sure. Thank you for the question.
Sorry. Hi, Steven. Steven, this is Lakota. I met you several times in San Francisco.
I'm gonna move outside. It's getting dark in here, so I'll move outside here. All right. Okay, hello.
I have, so one thing I want to say is I've seen you in a lot of places, watched you grow over the years. And the one thing that you have so much respect from our community because of your accountability to community. I saw this quote yesterday and it shows a Native woman. It says, you can't influence Native community if you're disconnected from it. And in your travels and all that's coming at you, what advice would you have for young artists, entrepreneurs, you know, who want to remain connected, I guess? What advice do you have for them?
I mean, I'm sure like a lot of people watching this, I love Indian people. I just love them. You know, I want the best for us. I think we're so smart and funny, and I love what's really cool. So being Kiowa and Choctaw, it's two separate, I mean, culturally, the Choctaws probably have more in common with the Irish people than they do the Kiowa people. You know, they were farmers. So when you take someone from maybe, let's say, the Seminoles in Florida to someone from the upper Northwest coast, actually culturally, they're not the same, but we have a shared experience over these past 500 years. Man, you can make a joke and they're gonna get it. And that's what I love about Indian country. I love it because I get to have a shorthand with Indian country. I can make an art project and they get it because of a shared experience. So I just think it's awesome. But you know, like anyone else, I mean, I don't know if it's like anyone else, but like I grew up, man, sometimes, you know, I was like, I remember when I was in the seventh grade, I was like wearing long sleeve shirts and I didn't want to get browner. I just wanted to try to like not let anyone, like I was like, oh my gosh, man, just let me just get through school. I don't want anyone picking on me. I don't want them making fun of me. And I remember I was sitting at school at Haskell. This is at Haskell Indian Nation University. I remember I looked around the classroom and everyone was brown skinned or at least they were native. If they didn't look physically native, they were native or they wouldn't be there. And I was like, whoa, this is what it would look like 200 years ago. Like, this is so neat, all these indigenous people here. And it was really started, it really started then when I was my first into college and meeting other Indian people from all over the country that really, you know, that made me like, whoa, there's some dope people here. It opened up my eyes for sure. And it was great seeing you.
Thank you so much. Kit Thomas, did you want to ask a question?
Hey, Steven Segal. I'm Mohawk from upstate New York in Canada. I'm from Mohawk Nation of the Iroquois. I just want to say, I also am an...
Uh-oh. It cut off. You cut off. It muted.
Okay, sorry about that. Can you...
Yes, there we go.
Okay. I don't know how much you heard, but
You're from upstate New York.
Oh yeah, I'm Mohawk, by the way.
The iron workers,
the amazing Iroquois Confederacy. I have. Oh yes, yes, yes. All my uncles and all the dads out there and cousins. Yep. But yeah, I'm so glad I actually get to talk to you. I've been a fan. I've been doing this kind of in the biz now for like, I think 11 years, just putting in the grunt work and everything that you said. I just want to thank you very much. I touched base with your work years ago and it immediately caught me because of the simplicity, but the strength of the messages. Like you said, how all across Indian Nation, we all get that, you know, we all get that humor, we all get that joke, we all get the, we all, you know, you could say one word and like Skoden, we know what that is. Like, but I like the fact that when I look more into your work, I thought you were just a painter at first, but now I see all these complexities of you and it makes me want to now go into film. I want to write my own work. I want like start scripting because primarily I'm just a visual artist, but I'm not trying to promote, but I started going out and doing merchandise and seeing you is an inspiration. So thank you.
Hey, promote it up. What's your website? You got all kinds of people watching.
All right, guys. Okay. It's kitthomasart.com. Kitthomasart.com. Or you can check me out on my Instagram, kitthomasart.
Follow her on Instagram.
Yes, thank you. And thank you for the kind words. And I'll just throw this out there too, man. There are tons of people that are way better artists than me, but just keep, I like to make stuff and it's resonated with people, but I'll get up some days and I'll be like, man, you should just quit. This is like, you're the worst, man. You're like, you're a fraud, dude. This is horrible. Why would anyone like this? And then some days I get up, I'm like, you're a genius. So you just gotta kind of, you know, it's ups and downs, man. So just stay level because everyone has those doubts for sure and keep grinding.
All right, we have another question in the chat. It says, what made you decide to use dice for your large pieces you showed?
Oh yeah, I think I kind of answered that earlier. I saw it on the tattoo show. I saw it, but it was like pixelated. And I was just thinking, I bet if you used more, it could look real. So that was my thought. So I got online, I just Googled dice in bulk and I found a place in Nebraska. And I was like, I need 20,000 dice. And they're like, what? We only have 10,000, but we'll order another 10. So they did, they ordered me another 20,000. I thought they'd be more excited though, you know? Like I felt like I bought their swimming pool for them. They were like, all right, yeah, whatever, dude. I was like, that's it, whatever. I just bought you out, but anyway.
I had a follow-up question to that. How long did that dice piece take you?
Oh, you know, I didn't time it. I don't know. I worked on it for 2 weeks, I think, every day, just. When I went to Sundance Film Festival, when they asked me to come out there and do it, I was asked by, they had this thing called the Native Lab. So I think Illuminatives might have brought me out. I'm sorry for the other people that brought me out, but I remember they were one of them. They said, hey, can you do this in 3 days? I was like, there is no way. So they said, we'll give you 7 days. So I went out there and started working on 7 days, but I brought two helpers out. And I paid, so once I laid it out, it was just, there was three of us just trying to jam on it to get it done. So I know I definitely did one in about 4 days, but that was with help. And it was like no sleep, man. It was crazy.
I had a question that's a little bit, it's off of what you were talking about. What year did you go to high school? Because my dad went to school there for a little while too.
Yeah, but I was there back in 95, 96, 97.
Okay. Yeah, I think that's when my dad was there. That's so crazy. Maybe you met him once upon a time.
Met him out there. Haskell Rascals. I love Haskell.
We have a question in the chat. Can you talk a little bit about your choice of using archival photos in your art? How did you go about finding these historical photos?
Well, yeah, that's a great funny question. I mean, not funny, but it's really interesting because now, man, the internet's changed so much, even just in the past, 7 or 8 years. When I first started trying to find, for example, Jesse Ed Davis, he's a Kiowa guitarist. I think he's another tribe too, so forgive me for not mentioning his other tribe, but he's Kiowa. He's a famous guitarist. I love Jesse Ed. I remember back then I used to look for pictures of him. It was three photos would come up. And now there's pictures of him with, you know, John Lennon and all this. So it was the same way with archival photos. Actually, the first ones I had to find, I couldn't find them online. I would find them on Facebook. There was a site that used to be called Old Native American Photos. I don't know if you guys remember that site. It was like Old Native American Photos. And that's where I actually had originally started getting these photos. I don't know where they were getting them because I was Googling back then. They just weren't even coming up. Now, fortunately, I've been able to link up, anyone can do this, but the National Archives, the Smithsonian, they're free. You can just get on there and download them. And they're pretty big size actually now. So, and I love seeing older images with newer images. I don't know, something about that. For me personally, I just dig it. I love it. It moves me. Are you hearing the wind now? Hello? Is the wind blowing on my microphone? Okay. All right. Any other questions?
I just have a statement. I don't know. Can you hear me? My name's Lenova. I'm in Phoenix, Dene. And I just, I love your work. You're seriously a genius. I follow you on your socials, and whenever I see something new, I'm just in love with everything that you do. And I think a lot of it is because I share a similar liking to like your Space Invaders. You know, as a kid growing up, I played that game. It was like one of my favorites. And then just seeing the image of the natives, and then, you know, just everything about it, I'm just like in love with the photo. I'm just like, this is so awesome. So I really love that. And I've never heard you talk before. So like see you in this Zoom meeting, I love your personality. It's just like I didn't picture you just so bubbly like this. I always thought you were like just very serious. So it's really cool to see you, in this, you know, this space, and to see how you are in real life. And I'm like just so excited. I'm like trying not to fangirl, but like, you're so cool. I just really love everything that you do.
Well, I just want to say, and as sincere as I can say this, thank you for taking the time to even say that. Like I said, I wake up some days and I am like questioning myself, and I'm like so down on myself. So I appreciate you saying that. I try to take the time now to thank people in my life that I dig, because I don't want to stand up at someone's funeral and be like, this person meant something to me. So what you said, I take it to heart, and it actually helps me when those times I start feeling bad. I remember that there are people out there that dig what I do, so I appreciate that. And I may be in Phoenix. I got an old band that I'm working on that I'm trying to see if I can bring out for the election for people that can't get to the election, the polls. I want to pick people up in this van that I'm working on, so I may be out in Arizona.
That is so awesome. And I do have your, I ordered that package through Bethany that you collaborated with.
Yeah, the boat package, yeah.
I hope I see you. I will be wearing the shirt, carrying the tote, wearing the mask. That's just so awesome. So
thank you. Awesome.
I will follow you and see and make sure that I see when you're coming out.
Dope, cool.
Thank you.
try to turn off the mic. Any other questions?
I have a question real quick. It is just really fast. What's your astrology sign?
I don't know. August 29th is when I was born. I actually don't know the sign.
It's a Virgo.
I'm a Virgo, man. Yeah. Tell me my lottery numbers now, you know? All right. Anybody else?
I have a question. For someone starting out in graphic design,
yeah,
are there any programs that you can recommend that are like cheap or free?
Man, unfortunately, when I started out, I have kind of it kind of became pretty well known. I did a fake boxing poster with Sitting Bull and Custer. That was the very first ever Photoshop I ever did. And the way I did it was I Googled cool poster tutorials, and that came up. And back then, you could use Photoshop. You could bootleg it back then. So I had it for free. Now I pay $9 a month for it. But I use Photoshop. I only know four things in Photoshop, but those same four things, I'm pretty salty with it. So I'm able to do everything with only four little pieces of knowledge. I do have a business partner with the natives, and he is a graphic designer. I know when I send my stuff to him, I'm so embarrassed because there's probably quicker ways to do it, and I'm doing it some real crazy ways. But I would definitely, I want to learn Illustrator, so I need to study that. But I know for sure I learned Photoshop 100% just by doing a tutorial online. I said cool Photoshop tutorials. A boxing poster came up. I started doing it, and I thought, wait a minute. I don't have to do use their images. I can do something I want to see. And that's what I did. So I would encourage whoever it is, if it's you or whoever it is, to do things that you want to see made, because then that 2-hour Photoshop tutorial feels like 15 minutes because you're so excited because you're building something you want to see and you have an ending product.
Thank you. We have one last question. Shaikea, if you want to ask your question, feel free.
Oh, okay. So I'm a Haskell Rascal, and I was wanting to ask how your art style sort of formed. Like, what medium did you first get into, and how did you branch off into what you do now?
Yeah, so I guess I started off in film. I wrote on a TV show for a little while. Acrylics is what I use. I love graphic design. I love advertising, that kind of art form. When I was a kid, I wanted neat, and you get to make up commercials and advertising. So that's kind of
Steven, we can't hear you.
Uh-oh, what happened?
I don't know.
No one hear me? Can you hear me now?
No? Yes.
Now we can.
Oh my gosh. I just gave you guys the keys to the universe and you couldn't, oh my gosh. I don't even remember what I said, but it was like the most awesome thing. It went dark. Can you still hear me now?
Now we can.
Okay. Anyway, I don't remember what I said. I don't know how much you heard, but the long story short of it is I just like keep making stuff. We wrote a book called The Last Powwow. Please check that out if you get a chance, with Thomas Yapaw. And I'm not exactly sure. I don't know how much I answered that you could hear, but I just started making things and I just keep going with that style. Thank you, everyone, for, I'm so honored that you guys listened to me tonight. If you have any questions, you can hit me up on social media, but thank you so much.
Well, thank you, Steven. I don't know if the student organization want to say anything in closing, but I'll let them, and then I will close up the Zoom event.
Thank you all for joining us in this community. I know we are all across the nation, but together in solidarity, we are rising as Indigenous peoples. I just want to say to follow Native Bruins on Instagram. We will be hosting more events, and hopefully maybe in the future we can make some UCLA gear with Steven. So looking forward to collaboration, but also you all are always welcome into our Native Bruin community. Thank you.
Thank you.
And Steven, thank you so much for sharing your remarkable work. Shannon, did you want to say something quickly before I close out?
No, just say thank you. Thank you to the students who organized this. Thanks, PJ, for your work organizing it. And thank you so much, Stephen. It was really a wonderful presentation. I know we all really, really enjoyed it.
Thank you, everyone. And it was good seeing you again, Pamela.
Sure. Well, in closing, I hope you all enjoy these cultural Zoom events offered by the UCLA American Indian Studies Center and the American Indian Student Association. If you wish to help to continue our work, please consider donating by visiting our webpage at aisc.ucla.edu. And yes, and continue to follow us on social media so you can hear about our great events that we're having at the American Indian Studies Center. And this concludes our Zoom event. Thank you.